Good morning all, welcome back to analysis of indeterminate structures. In today's session, let us solve one more problem on continuous beam which is subjected to uniformly distributed load and point load as shown in figure. Yes, in this problem also we maintain the same steps as we followed in the previous problem. Let us solve this problem by following those simple steps. Yes, as you know, in this given beam, first we need to find out the degree of static indeterminacy. So that will be our first step. And you all know degree of static indeterminacy can be found out by using the simple formula, that is number of unknown reactions in the given beam minus known equilibrium conditions. So if you count the number of unknown reactions here, at A we have two, one vertical and one moment, at B one vertical, at C one vertical, and at D again one vertical. So the number of unknown reactions will be 5 minus known equilibrium conditions in case of beams will be 2. So if you solve this equation, we get degree of static indeterminacy as 3. So at this step itself, we'll get to know the size of matrix, that is F matrix, will be 3×3, and at the end we should find out the 3 unknowns. So in step number 1, our next sub-step will be to assume the unknowns, that is redundants. Here in this particular problem, again I am going to take moments as unknown. So if you see, at D, since it is a simple support, moment at D, that is MDC, will be 0. That you can mark here itself. Clear? Then moment at A, moment at B, moment at C. So these are the 3 redundants we can take in this particular problem. Therefore, take redundants as MA, MB and MC. Since B and C are the 2 continuous supports, here at MB we can take MBA or MBC as redundants, and at C again we get 2 moments here, MCB and MCD as redundants. So in particularly, at A I'll take MAB as redundant, at B I'll take MBA as redundant, and at C I'll take MCB as redundant. In place of MBA you can take MBC also. Here MCB, instead of this you can take MCD also. Clear? So these 3 are the redundants. At last we will find these 3 moments. Next, let us write the released determinate structure from the given beam. So given beam is the indeterminate structure. From that we'll write the released determinate structure. So as you can see, this is the released determinate structure. So on this beam, we are going to mark the assumed redundants. So as usual, this is A, this is B. Since B and C are the common supports, you can write them like this. So now, I'm going to mark MAB here. This is first redundant and second redundant is MB. Together these 2 moments are called as MB. In particular, this moment is called as MBA and this is MBB. C. And again in this span also, I'll get two moments. This is MCB and this is MCD. So these are the three redundants we have assumed. So this figure B is called released structure or determinate structure. Next, after assuming the redundance, we are going to mark the coordinate directions, general coordinate directions along the assumed redundance. So for that, take the beam like this. So on this beam, you just mark the coordinate direction. This is coordinate number 1 and this is coordinate number 2, and here you can take the coordinate number 3. So as usual, span remains as it is here also. Clear? So this is called figure C, which is showing general coordinate direction. So if you compare the previous problem, in previous problem we have got DSI as 2. Here we have got DSI as 3. That's why we have 3 general coordinates here. So this completes step number 1, finding the degree of static indeterminacy, assuming the redundance and marking both the redundance and general coordinates as shown in figure B and figure C. Moving further, let us take step number 2. In step number 2, by keeping figure B as reference, we need to sketch bending moment diagram. Then using that bending moment diagram, we need to draw the conjugate beam. That means the bending moment diagram, whatever we are going to sketch, by using this beam as reference, that BMD will act as load on conjugate beam. BMD superimposed on EI diagram, we call it as M by EI diagram, that will be act as load on conjugate beam. So if you observe the supports in all the spans, span AB, BC and CD, in all the spans we have simple supports. Therefore, in conjugate beam also we get simple supports. Clear? And if you look into the loading, we have UDL, point load. Again, on CD span we have UDL. Therefore, the nature of bending moment diagram will be either parabola or linear. For point load we get in linear fashion, for UDL we get parabolic variation. Clear? So that is regarding bending moment. So let us draw the bending moment diagram for figure B. So for span AB, since it is UDL, we'll get parabolic variation. For span BC, the bending moment variation will be linear, and if you take span CD, the bending moment variation will be parabolic. So this is the pattern of BMD we get for this loading. Clear? If you take figure B as reference. To find the maximum values, at this point we can use the formula WL square by 8. Here, in previous problem we have central point load, here we have asymmetrical point load, therefore we can use WAB by L, and here at center the maximum bending moment will be WL square by 8. So if you use these formula, we get the values of bending moment at the required points. WL square by 8 gives the maximum bending moment exactly at the center of the span, and WAB by L, we get the bending moment under the point load 120 kN. So if you substitute the respective value and solve here for the first span, the bending moment value will be 720 kN/m. And for the second span, W is 120, A is 4 meters and B is 8 meters. The total span is 12 meters. If you substitute and solve, you get 320 kN/m. And for the last span, W is 20 and L is 12. If you substitute here, you get the bending moment value as 360 kN/m. Since all the bending moments are positive, the loading on conjugate beam will be in downward direction. So this is bending moment diagram for figure B. And you know, at simple support, the bending moment values are zero. So you can call it as figure D. Next, we need to sketch the conjugate beam. You all know, in conjugate beam, if we take the real beam as reference, that is figure B, in real beam we have simple supports. Therefore, here also we get simple supports itself at A, at B, and again for the second span at B and at C, and the last span C and D. Clear? Since it is a conjugate beam, so we call it as A dash, B dash, B dash, C dash. This is C dash and D dash. So these are the conjugate beams. And span remain as it is. So we have 12 meters. In real beam also we have 12 meters. Here also we can have 12 meters. Now load this bending moment diagram along with the EI diagram on this conjugate beam, that is M by EI diagram, that will act as a load. And if you mark the loading, since we have positive bending moment, the loading will be in downward direction. And if you take these values, this is 720 divided by EI, and this value is 320 divided by EI, and this value is 360 divided by EI. This is how we are going to sketch the conjugate beam. So you can call this as figure E and give a name as conjugate beam. Yes, in our next steps we require reactions, so you can mark the reactions here as RA dash, this is RB dash, and for the second span also this is RB dash, RC dash, RC dash and RD. So this completes our step number 2. Further, in step number 3, we make use of flexibility matrix relation. You all know flexibility matrix relation is given by D is equal to F into P. So again, this D can be written as matrix D minus matrix DL, that equals to matrix F into matrix P. So call this as equation A. Again, if you read the problem statement, here they have not given any sinking regarding supports. Therefore, you can neglect this D. If they give only any sinking of supports or rotation at the support, this D we are going to calculate. Otherwise, you can simply neglect this displacement matrix. And yes, of course, we are going to calculate the displacement matrix because of the applied load, then flexibility matrix, then matrix force that is given by P. Again, I have already told you this DL matrix and P matrix are column matrix, and based on the degree of static indeterminacy we have got, we can write the size of these two matrices. DL matrix is of size 3 cross 1, this is also 3 cross 1, and F is always the square matrix of order 3 cross 3. Here in this particular problem, we got the F matrix size as 3 cross 3. Now, in step number 3, we are going to find out all these elements one by one. To begin with, let us find DL matrix, that is displacement matrix because of applied loading. Yes, to find this displacement matrix, we make use of figure E, the conjugate beam. So, we all know if you want to get any slope in real beam, we should find the shear force in conjugate beam. So we are finding the displacement in the form of theta. Therefore, if you want theta at A, B, C and D, we need to find the shear force at A dash, B dash, C dash and D dash. But if you look into the coordinates, whatever we have marked the coordinates at A position, B and C. Therefore, here the displacements will happen at A, that can be treated as theta A, at B, theta B, at C, theta C. Therefore, we can write DL matrix as D1L, D2L and D3L. So, in precise, I can write it as, at coordinate number 1 we get theta A, at coordinate number 2 we get theta B, at coordinate number C we get theta C. Now our job is to find out these three elements. To find them, we need, see, D1L equals to theta A, and that can be equated to shear force at A dash. Refer figure E, that is conjugate beam, to get these shear forces. Clear? So that means shear force at A dash, if you look into this particular span, shear force at A dash will be RA dash. And if you take D2L, this is theta B, and this will be equated to shear force at B dash. If you take shear force at B dash, since B dash is a common support, you should add RB dash twice. First reaction is because of span A dash B dash, and second reaction is because of B dash and C dash span. And third element is theta C. So theta C can be equated to shear force at C dash. Since C dash is also a common support, you get RC dash plus RC dash plus RC dash. This is because of the span B dash C dash, and this is C dash D dash. If you write the outline like this, it is very simple to analyze the problem. Now look here, just we need to find these reactions. It is very simple. We can use the simple logic, that is total load divided by 2 if it is symmetrical. If it is unsymmetrical, we can apply the equilibrium conditions, that is moment equilibrium and force equilibrium condition. Now let us calculate the respective reactions for the conjugate beam. So if you find the reactions in this particular conjugate beam by referring figure E, so look at the span, the first span, it is symmetrical beam and the variation of load is parabola. Therefore, to find RA dash and RB dash for span A dash B dash, you can use total load divided by 2. The total load will be calculated as 2 by 3 of base into height. Height of this is 720 divided by EI whole divided by 2. Clear? 2 by 3 of base into height divided by 2. So, if you solve this particular equation, we get the final answer for RA dash and RB dash as 2880 divided by EI. And coming to the last span, that is C dash and D dash. Since it is also symmetrical and parabolic variation, we can take that span first. So here RC dash and RD dash can be find out by using the same formula. 2 by 3 into span, again it has the same span 12 meters and height is 360 by EI. Total load divided by 2. So if you solve this particular equation, we get the reactions at RC dash and RD dash as 1440 divided by EI. So now take up the middle span, that is B dash and C dash. Since here we don't have symmetrical loading, we can get these reactions by using moment equilibrium condition. So here for span B dash and C dash, we can apply moment equilibrium condition. Take moment about B dash and equate it to 0. As usual, I'll take the sign convention clockwise as positive. Take moment about this particular point. It is minus RC dash into 12. Then because of this triangular load, what will be the moment? So that you need to write. You can look here, we have two separate triangular parts, part 1 and part 2. So you can take moment about B dash because of this triangular loading and also because of the second triangular loading. Clear? So as usual, if I take the first triangular loading, it is half into base is 4 meters. See, the base is 4 meters and height will be 320 divided by EI. And for triangles, you know, from the apex, the centroid locates at 2/3 of L and from the base, the centroid locates at the 1/3 of L. Since we are taking moment about this point, for because of this first triangular load, the perpendicular distance will be 2 by 3 into 4 and the second triangular load is half into base is 8 meters, this portion, the base is 8 meters and 320 divided by EI is the height multiplied by the perpendicular distances. This is a base and here it is 1 by 3 into 8 plus the remaining distance is 4 and this entire equation is equals to 0. If you solve this particular equation, RC dash equals to 853.33 divided by EI. So for all these spans AB dash and CD dash also, you can use the same procedure to get the reactions. To avoid time consumption, we can easily apply this formula whenever we have symmetrical beams. So we got RC dash. We need to find out this RB dash. We have applied moment equilibrium condition. Next, we can apply force equilibrium condition to get one more reaction. Force equilibrium condition will be summation of Fy equals to 0, upward forces as positive. If you take this particular beam, so look at the upward forces, it is RB dash plus RC dash and downward forces will be because of this triangle, first triangle, half into base into height, it is 320 divided by EI. Then second triangle, minus half into base is 8, height is 320 divided by EI. Minus because all the loads are acting in downward direction. So we can find only this much vertical forces in this particular loading diagram. So if you solve this particular equation, we got RC dash already as 853.33. If you substitute that value and if you solve this particular equation, we are going to get the RB dash value as 1066.67 divided by ER. So now we have calculated reactions at all the points. So now we already framed the outline. D1L equals to theta A, that is also equals to shear force at A dash. So our shear force at A dash is equals to RA dash. Like that, we have formulated all the equations for all the three displacements. So now just substitute the respective value. RA dash is equals to 2880 divided by EI. And RB dash is the summation of this value, 2880 by EI, and this value. From both the span, you should take the RB dash. If you sum up those two values, you get 3946.67 divided by EI for RB dash. And in the same manner, for RC dash, we need to sum up this value along with this. So if you do so, you get the RC dash value as 2293.33 divided by EI. So these are the displacement values we are going to get at respective coordinates. So mark them here. Since in all the positions we have EI, 1 by EI is common, take out that 1 by EI outside, and theta A is 2880 and theta B is 3946.67 and theta C is 2293.33. So this completes the calculation of DL matrix. In the same manner, by following the same procedure, we need to calculate the elements in the F matrix. Yes, after getting the DL matrix, next we need to find the F matrix. In F matrix, we have the size of order 3 cross 3. So let us first write the elements inside the F matrix. So here, if you take the F matrix of order 3 cross 3, as usual, we write the elements column wise. So in first column, we get F11, F21, F31. In second column, we have F12, F22, and F32. And in the last column, we have F13. F23 and F33. Clear? As usual, you all know, if I write in general manner Fij, this jth place always represents the force and ith place represents the displacement. And we are going to get all these elements inside the F matrix column wise. First, we are going to apply unit moment at coordinate number 1 and we check the displacement at coordinate number 1, 2 and 3 respectively. Thus, we are going to get the first column elements. And we repeat the same procedure at coordinate number 2 and at coordinate number 3. So, while finding the elements for F matrix, we should remove all the externally applied loads and just we need to apply the unit forces. So, let us find the first column elements here. To find the first column elements, apply यूनिट मोमेंट एट कोऑर्डिनेट नंबर वन एंड चेक द डिस्प्लेसमेंट एट कोऑर्डिनेट नंबर वन टू एंड थ्री. क्लियर? इन पर्टिकुलर इफ आई वॉन्ट एफ वन वन रिप्रेजेंट्स रोटेशन एट कोऑर्डिनेट नंबर वन ड्यू टू यूनिट मोमेंट एट कोऑर्डिनेट नंबर वन. That's why we call it as F11. So this is also equals to theta A, and this can be equated to shear force at A dash. The same outline, whatever we did to find the DL matrix, same work we repeat here. And what is F21? Same notations you can write. F21 is the rotation at coordinate number 2 due to unit moment at coordinate number 1. This force is constant we apply at coordinate number 1, and we are going to check the displacement in the form of rotation at all the coordinates, and this can be equated to theta b, and this is equal to shear force at b dash. When I say shear force at b dash, it is equals to rb dash because of both the span, and here it is equals to ra dash. And F31 is the theta c, that is rotation at coordinate number 3 because of the unit moment applied at coordinate number 1, and again this is also equals to shear force at c dash, that is rc dash from both the spans. We require slopes at real beam, therefore we need to find the shear force at conjugate beam. So to get all these values, we need to draw the conjugate beam again. So that we are going to write now. We know first we write the real beam. Here the real beam will be like this. As usual, write the three spans: span AB, span BC, and span CD. Remove all the externally applied load. If you observe figure A, so we have UDL point load, and again we have UDL. We remove all other loads and we apply only the unit load at coordinate number 1. Since we are finding the first column elements at coordinate number 1, we are applying unit moment. And we have span as 12 meters for all the three spans. This is span AB, this is BC, and this is CD. So this is figure F, and we can call this as real beam. By referring this beam, we are going to draw the conjugate beam. So if you draw the conjugate beam along with the M by EI diagram as loading, we get, see, first I'll write conjugate beam for span BC and CD. Since both the spans has no loading, see here you can call it as A dash, B dash, B dash, C dash, C dash, and D dash. See, you observe span BC and CD are free from loading, therefore here you won't get any kind of loading on conjugate beam also. So if you take span AB, we have unit moment here, therefore if you write the bending moment diagram, you get right angle pattern, and for that BMD, if you load the EI diagram, you get M by EI diagram, and here we have the intensity as 1 by EI. Since the bending moment is positive, the loading will be in downward direction. So this is the conjugate beam for figure F. You can call this as figure G, and this is conjugate beam. As usual, we need all the reactions. Therefore, you can mark the reactions as Ra dash, Rb dash, Rb dash, Rc dash. This is also Rc dash, and this is Rd dash. Now, this is our conjugate beam. By referring this particular beam, we can calculate the reactions. So, as usual, if the beam is symmetrical, you can use total load divided by 2, or else you can use the moment equilibrium conditions. And since we have got this particular pattern, we can use the factors for the total load calculated. For first, we calculate the total load for this particular triangle. The total load will be W, and this W will be half into base is 12 and height is 1 by EI. Therefore, the total load will be 6 by EI. And obviously, this acts exactly at the centroid. Centroid locates from the distance 1/3 from base and 2/3 from apex point. So now let us calculate the reactions. Ra dash equals to the total load is W and the value is 6 by EI. Ra dash is situated at the base point, so I just multiply the factor 2 by 3. And Rb dash equals to total load is 6 by EI multiply the factor 1/3, because it is situated at the apex point. If you solve this, you get 4 by EI. 6 rules are 12 divided by 3, it is 4 by EI, and this is 2 by EI. This is for span A dash, B dash, the first span. If you take the second span and the last span, since they are free from loading, the reactions Rb dash equals to 0, here Rc dash equals to 0. And here also I'll get Rc dash equals to 0 and Rd dash equals to 0. This is how we can calculate the reactions. Once we got the values for reactions, we can simply substitute the values here. Clear? So F11 is theta A. Theta is shear force at A dash. At A dash we get Ra dash as the shear force, and the value will be 4 by EI. And to find theta B, it is the summation of Rb dash from both the span. So here it is 2 by EI plus 0. Don't get confused. It is 2 by EI plus 0. That will be equal to 2 by EI. And again, since C is also common support, we get two reactions at C dash, Rc dash and Rc dash. Both the values are 0. Therefore, theta C is equals to 0. So this completes the calculation of first column elements. In the same manner, we are going to get the second and third column elements. Let us find the second and third column elements. Yes, to get the second column elements, we need to apply unit moment at coordinate number 2, and we should check the displacement at coordinate number 1, 2 and 3. So you know the second column elements are F12, F22 and F32. So to get F12, we apply unit moment at coordinate number 2 and we check the rotation at coordinate number 1. Therefore, it is F12. In the same manner, we apply the unit moment at coordinate number 2 and we check the displacement at respective position, that is 2 and 3. You all know at coordinate number 1 we get theta A, at 2 we get theta B, and at 3 we get theta C. We just formulate the outline like this. Theta A in real beam will be equal to shear force at A dash. Theta B in real beam equals to shear force at B dash. And theta C will be equated to shear force at C dash. And all these shear force we should find by referring conjugate beam. So if you see the figure H, that is real beam. Now we need to apply the unit moment at coordinate number 2. And by keeping this diagram as reference, if we sketch the BMD, and after loading that BMD on EI diagram, we should use that M by EI diagram as loading on conjugate beam. Let us write the conjugate beam here. So if you write the conjugate beam here, so this is for first span A dash B dash, and this is the second span B dash C dash, and this is the last span C dash and D dash. Clear? And as usual, since we have 1 kN at point B, we get the bending moment diagram like this. At A, the moment is zero. And again, at C, the moment is zero. Since CD is free from loading, you won't get any kind of load, that is BMD, on C dash and D dash. So the intensity of these two triangles will be same, that is 1 by EI, and at A dash and B dash, the moment will be 0. Since we have got the positive bending moment, the loading will be in downward direction. So as usual, here we need to find the reactions RA dash, RB dash, RB dash, this is RC dash and RD dash. If you find the load, total load here, this is W, and here also it is W. So if you do it, it is half into base is 12 and height is 1. So if you solve this, you get 6 by EI. Since for both the loading, span and intensity, that is height, is same, both the W's are same, 6 by EI. So now you find the reactions here. Here the reactions will be, so RA dash is the apex point, therefore 6 by EI into 1 by 3, and RB dash is the base point, therefore 6 by EI into 2 by 3, and if you solve this you get 2 by EI, and here if you solve this you get 4 by EI. So this is for span A dash B dash. If you do for the span B dash and C dash, again RB dash is at the base point, therefore total load is 6 by EI into 2 by 3. So you get 4 by EI, and RC dash is at the apex, therefore 6 by EI into 1 by 3, you get 2 by EI. And for the last span, since it has no loading, RC dash equals to 0 and RD dash is also equals to 0. So now if you substitute these values here, theta A, shear force at A dash, this will become 2 by EI, and RB dash, that is shear force at B dash, is because of this, 4 by EI plus 4 by EI, this will be 8 by EI. And if you take shear force at C dash, so that will be equals to 2 by EI plus 0, the final value is 2 by EI. So like this we can get the second column elements. Now let us find the last column elements by using the same procedure. Now as usual, just write the outline to find the third column elements. Apply unit moment at coordinate number 3. Now we are going to apply the unit moment at 3, and we are going to check the rotations, that is displacement, at coordinate number 1, 2 and 3. That's how we get F13, F23 and F33. Clear? So to get F13, we need to apply the unit moment at coordinate number 3. So we get rotation at coordinate number 1. And by using the conjugate beam theorem, we have theta A equals to shear force at A dash, and theta B equals to shear force at B dash, and theta C equals to shear force at C dash. So all these gives F13, F23 and F33. F23 is what? It is the rotation at coordinate number 2 due to unit moment at coordinate number 3. So now let us draw the conjugate beam for this particular real beam. So if you draw the conjugate beam, as usual the span remains as it is, and simple supports remains as simple supports. So this is A dash and B dash. Since A dash and B dash is free from loading, we won't get any loading on this conjugate beam also. And here for B dash and C dash, since we have 1 kilonewton meter moment here. So we get the loading pattern like this. And here, both the intensity will be equal to 1 by EI. Since it is a positive bending moment, loading will be in downward direction. Moment at D dash and moment at B dash is 0. At C dash, we have 1 by EI because we have applied 1 kilonewton meter there. So it is B dash, this is C dash, this is D dash. As usual, we have the space, same span. And these are the reactions, RA dash, RB dash, RB dash, RC dash. And this is also RC dash, this is RD dash. And if you calculate the total loading because of this triangular load, the total loading, let me mark it as W. And if you calculate that, half into base into height, so you get again 6 by EI. Since if you observe both the diagrams, the span and height are same, you get 6 by EI here also. It need not be mandatory to get 6 by EI for both the triangular loading. Since the span and height are same, we are getting the same load. That is the total load, which acts exactly at the centroid of the triangle. Now, as usual, we calculate these reactions. See, the procedure is very simple. If you know how to sketch the bending moment diagram and conjugate beam for the given loading pattern, we are just repeating the procedure. We have done the same procedure to get DL and all the three columns in F matrix. So reactions here, for span 1, that is A dash, B dash, RA dash is 0 and RB dash is also 0. And for span B dash and C dash, since RB dash is located at apex, 6 by EI, the total load multiplied by 1 by 3. RC dash equals to 6 by EI, the total load multiplied by 2 by 3. So this will become 2 by EI and this is 4 by EI. And the last span, RC dash, since it is located at the base, it is total load into 2 by 3. Therefore, this will be equal to 4 by EI. And the last reaction, RD dash, so even though we don't need this RD dash, you just calculate it, 6 by EI into 1 by 3. This is 2 by EI. Because we never use this RD dash, clear? Because we don't need the displacement at that particular point. So if you substitute the respective values here, theta A, it is equal to RA dash. We don't have any reaction there, therefore it is 0. And RB dash is because of this value and this value, 0 plus 2 by EI, the total load is 2 by EI. And the last is because of C, it is RC dash. And RC dash at the last span, we get 8 by EI. So this completes the calculation of elements in the F matrix. Now in step 3, the last part is to substitute the respective values of DL matrix and F matrix and to calculate the unknown matrix P by using simple mathematical operations. So if you take out 1 by S common and if we write all the elements in F matrix, we get these values. 4, 2, 0 in first column, 2, 8, 2 in second column and 0, 2, 8 in the last column. And you know this is considered as principal diagonal element. And if you observe the elements, they are symmetrical. See, F21 and F12 are symmetrical. F31 and F13 are symmetrical and F32 and F23 are symmetrical. That means if you find F21, it is enough. F12 is equal to F21. That logic we can use in upcoming problems. Substitute all the values here in this particular equation A and let us see. You know D matrix is given by 1 by EI into 2800 And the second element in DL matrix is 3946.67, and the last value is 2293.33. And substitute the values of F here, 1 by EI into, you know, the elements in F matrix are 4, 2, 0, then 2, 8, 2, then 0, 2, and 8. Then this P can be written as P1, P2, and P3. So EI and EI gets cancelled. So to get P1, P2, and P3, we should get the inverse of this particular matrix, that is F matrix, which should be multiplied by matrix DL. Therefore, we can rewrite the equation as 4, 2, 0, 2, 8, 2, 0, 2, 8. We need the inverse of this because this comes to this side and this will be at the denominator position. Therefore, we can write this like this, inverse of F matrix multiplied by, multiply this minus sign inside, it will become minus 2880 minus 3946.67, then minus 2293.33. So finally, get the answer like, so the P1 value will be minus 571.28 and P2 will be 297.44 and P3 will be 212.31. This is P1, P2 and P3. And you all know these forces, that is force at P1 is taken as MA, at P2 it is MB and at P3 it is MC. This MB is both MBA and MBC and MC is MCB and MCD. Let us mark these final moments on the given structure. MA, since it is anti-clockwise, you can write like this. It is 571.28. All the values are in kilonewton meter. Then MB, it is MBA and MBC. So one will be positive and another one will be negative. MBA is positive and MBC is negative. Therefore, it is 297.44. And at C, again, it is, one will be marked in clockwise direction and another one will be anti-clockwise direction. Clear? See, you have got the negative values, but the general coordinates we have assumed in the positive sense. That means at C we have assumed the coordinates like this, correct? Since we have got the negative value, you just mark the moments in opposite direction. We have initially assumed like this. Since we have got negative answer, we have just changed the direction of marking. So we got the final moments at A, B and C. So we left with step number 4, that is the calculation of shear force and bending moment, and we need to sketch the shear force diagram and bending moment diagram for the given beam. So here, after marking the bending moment values on the given beam, so we need to find the reactions at the supports, that is RA, RB, RC and RD. Then we need to find the shear force values, then bending moment values. So after that, we can sketch SFD and BMD. So let us find the reactions by drawing free body diagram for individual segments, like for AB, BC and CD. So if I take the first span, that is for AB, first you need to write the free body diagram of that particular span. So it's having the moment 571.28 kilonewton meter, and on the B side it is having 297.44 kilonewton meter. Then the intensity of UDL is 40 kilonewton per meter and the total span is 12 meters. This is A support and this is B support. At support A, we get the reaction RA. At support B, since it is an intermediate support, this can be written as RBA. Clear? So now, with the help of equilibrium conditions, we can find the reactions RA and RB. So you can take moment about A equals to 0, taking clockwise moments as positive, I have minus RBA into 12, then plus 40 into 12 into 6, that is 12 by 2, then clockwise moment, this is 297.44, then the anti-clockwise moment 571.28 equals to 0. If you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value for RBA as plus 217.18 kilonewton. Next, if you apply the another equilibrium condition, that is summation of Fy equals to 0, upward forces as positive. I have two upward forces, that is RA plus RBA. Clear? Then downward forces UDL, 40 into 12, that equals to 0. If you substitute RBA value here and if you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the reaction at A as it is 262.82 kilonewton. Clear? So like this, we can find the reactions for all the supports, for span BC and for span CD. So now let us take the span BC. So again, write the free body diagram for span BC. So we have one point load at a distance of 4 meters from support B. And you can mark the moment values here. The moments are at B, it is 297.44 kilonewton meters, and at C it is 212.31 kilonewton meters. Clear? And here you can call it as RBC and this is RCB. For intermediate values, you will get two subscripts, RBC and RCB. So now, as usual, apply moment equilibrium condition, take moment about B as 0 and clockwise moments as positive, minus RCB into 12, then plus 120 into 4, all clockwise moments are taken as positive, plus 212.31 minus 297.44 equals to 0. If you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value for RCB. And the value of RCB is, it is 32.90 kilonewton. Next we have summation of Fy equals to 0, upward forces as positive. We have two upward forces again here, one is RBC and another one is RCB. Then the downward forces minus 120 equals to 0. So substitute the value of RCB here and solve this equation and we are going to get the value of RBC as 87.09 kilonewton. This is for span BC. And if you take span CD, the last span, so this is also UDL. So similar to first span, we have two supports C and D subjected to UDL of intensity 20 kilonewton per meter and length of the span is 12 meters and we have moments like 212.31 kilonewton meters and since D is a simple support, the moment is 0 and the reactions are RCD and RD. Intermediate support, therefore it is RCD, and D is the last support, we get the reaction as RD. So now again, if you apply moment equilibrium condition by taking moment about C as 0. So we get minus Rd into 12, then plus 20 into 12 into 6, then minus 212.31 equals to 0. This moment is 0. Therefore, the value of Rd equals to, it is 102.30 kilonewton. And if you apply the equilibrium condition, summation of all vertical forces equals to 0 by taking upward forces as positive, we have Rcd plus Rd minus 20 into 12 equals to 0. Substitute the value of Rd here and solve this particular equation. We get the value for Rcd as 137.7 kilonewton. So, like this, we can find the reaction at the supports. Now, using these values, we can sketch the SFT. Now, we can mark these reactions on the beam at the respective position. So, here we'll get, so this is RA, and this is RB, this is RC, this is RD. For RB, we have two values. So, RA is 262.82 kilonewton, and for RB, we have two values. RBA is 217.18, and RBC is 87.09. Like that, for RC also, we have two values. One is RCB, it is 32.09, and RCD is 137.7, and finally the RD value is 102.30, and all these reactions will be in kilonewton. So now draw the reference line. Then take the datum line. Now here I have 262.82 in upward direction. Mark 262.82 here. Here we have 262.82 kilonewton. Then 262.82 minus 40 into 12. I'll get minus 217.18. So join these two lines linearly because we have UDL variation. Now this two is minus 278.18 plus 270.18 leads to 0. Again I have 87.09 moving in upward direction. Therefore I'll get 87.09, and that is constant till this point. Call this point as P. Therefore this is 87.09 kilonewton. So now it is plus 87.09 minus 120. So it gives me minus 32.09, and this will be constant till point C. So here minus 32.09 plus 32.09 leads to 0. Again I have plus 137.7. So we'll get here plus 137.7 kilonewton. Plus 137.7 minus 20 into 12 gives me minus 102.3. So join these two points linearly. So this is minus 102.3 kilonewton. So minus 102.3 plus 102.3 leads to 0. So above the reference line it is positive, below the reference line it is negative. So this is SFD for this particular beam structure. Now we have got two zero shear force points. Just mark these points on the beam. to find the bending moment at this particular position, you need to get the values first. Since I have taken this point as P, call this as Q, and call this particular point as R, and you can find the X value here. So I'll take this as X for this particular span. So you can call it as X1, and here you can call it as X2. Now we need to find the three bending moment values for this span AB, BC and CD at the position P, Q and R. Clear? Let us find the bending moments at these three positions. So on this beam, we have taken this point as Q. So from A to Q, the horizontal distance is taken as X1. So now we all know from the shear force diagram, the shear force at Q is equals to 0. So use this logic and find the shear force to the left of the section. So have RA minus 40 into X1. These are the only forces I can find to the left of this particular section. So this equals to 0. And if you solve this particular equation, and I know the value of RA, RA is 262.82 minus 40 into X1. If you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value of X1 as 6.57 meters. Now take moment about this particular point, that is MQ. To the left side of the section, we have RA into X1, then minus 571.28, then minus 40 into X1 into X1 divided by 2. So if you solve this particular equation, you are going to get the value for bending moment at Q, that is MQ, as it is 292.15, and it is positive bending moment. Clear? This is the bending moment value at Q point. Now, if I take this particular span BC, I need to find the bending moment at the point P. So here I know the position of this P. Therefore, I can directly find the bending moment at this particular position. I'll take bending moment to the left hand side. So it is RBC into 4 minus 297.44. So if you solve this particular equation, we are going to get the value for MP as it is 50.92 kilonewton meters. For the last span, again, this is similar to the span number 1, AB. So here also, I have point called R, which is situated at the unknown distance. First, I should find the distance from C. So let us mark this particular distance as X2. So now, mark the same on free body diagram also. This is R, and from C to R, the distance is taken as X2. So now, we all know that from the shear force diagram, FR equals to 0. That is, shear force at this particular position is 0. Therefore, it is RCD minus 20 into X2 equals to 0. I know the value of RCD. The value of RCD is 137.7. And if you solve this particular equation, we are going to get the value of X2 as it is 6.88 meters. Now take moment about this position. It is MR. I'll take to the left hand side of the R. Therefore, it is RCD into X2 minus 212.13 minus 20 into X2 into X2 divided by 2. You all know the value for RCD and X2. Substitute that. And if you solve this particular equation, we are going to get the value for bending moment at R as it is 261.65 kilonewton meters. And all the span moments are positive. That is, moment at Q, moment at P and moment at R. Now let us sketch the BMD by marking all these span moments and end moments. So as usual, mark the reference line So below the reference line, it is negative. Above the reference line, it is positive. So this downward arrow marks indicates moment to the downward direction of the datum. You should take, if the arrow marks are downward, you should take moment to the downside of the datum. So 571.28, it's acting in downward direction, therefore it is 571.28, and all the values are in kilonewton meters. Then it is 297.44. Next I have 212. It is 212.31, and at D it is 0. So first we mark the end moments. Next, the span moments. For span AB, it is 292. It is 292.15. Then at P, I have 50.92. And at R, I have 261.65. Clear? So now you join all these points according to the variation of loading. For UDL, join the points in parabolic nature. For point load, it is linear. So it is 0. Then for point load, it is a linear line. Again, for UDL, it is parabola. As usual, above the reference line it is positive, below the reference line it is negative. And if they ask you to draw the elastic curve based on the point of contraflexure, you all know, so point of contraflexure is a position where the bending moment changes its sign or the bending moment value is zero. So these are the point of contraflexures. So like this, you can sketch SFT and BMD for the values determined. So this completes the analysis of continuous beam by using flexibility approach. So the first two problems are very, very simple without any sinking of supports. In next session, I'm going to take up a continuous beam with support settlements. Thank you.